Welcome to Grimerica Goes Deep, Ancient Mystery and Lost Civilizations. This is Chapter 1, Atlantis with Randall Carlson. Thanks for joining us, Randall.
Well, thanks for having me, guys.
No problem. I think we should start off like big, high-level stuff. Like, what got you interested in Atlantis and what sort of is your definition of Atlantis?
Oh, what is my definition of Atlantis? What got me started in it? Which one should I take first? We'll go the definition of Atlantis was just essentially taken directly from Plato's dialogues, which is the prologue to Timaeus and Critias, where he talks about Atlantis. It's where the Atlantic Ocean get its name, right? If you pronounce the last letter of the word Atlantic, the sea, instead of a hard sea, a soft sea, it's literally, phonetically, Atlantis. And, yeah, I mean, you go to Encyclopedia Britannica, and it'll say, yes, put up the Atlantic Ocean. I don't know if they still do this, but in the older ones, they weren't afraid to say it, that, you know, Atlantic Ocean gets its name from, you know, Atlantis. So Atlantis, the question really comes down to, was it exclusively a contrivance of Plato, or was there some historical authenticity to the idea? And there's basically two schools of thought on that. One is that, and has been the predominant point of view for in most academic circles for many decades, and that is that it was a metaphor. Plato invented this metaphor to give some form to his concept of the idealized civic structure, the idealized society, the way he envisioned it. So that was pretty much the dominant academic view, but then there were those who deviated from it and said, no, behind that legend, there is some authentic reality, some history that actually happened. And that's been the two schools, of essentially. The school that, the historiographic school was the one that basically came up with various locations based upon a reading of Plato.
Right.
And there have been many places, and probably the most well-accepted explanation amongst the academic circles is that it was the eruption of Thira, the volcano Thira, on the island of Santorini.
Yeah.
Yes, which would have been about 3,500 years ago, and that this would have been roughly 900 years before Plato's time. And, you know, in Plato's dialogues, he mentions the chronology of Atlantis and the 10 kings and the demise of Atlantis after this great war between the imperialistic Atlanteans and the proto-Hellenic defenders of the Mediterranean area. And after this tremendous battle, tremendous war, which is placed at 9,000 years prior to Solon's exile in Egypt, which, given that that's roughly 600 BC, give or take a few decades, puts us right at about 11,600 years ago, or 9,600 BC. And which is interesting these days, because if you follow the whole question of the Younger Dryas, the transition from glacial to interglacial age, from Pleistocene to Holocene, you know that the termination of the Younger Dryas, the catastrophic termination of the Younger Dryas, climatic anomaly or excursion, whatever you want to call it, catastrophe, the end of that, the termination, is dated at about 11,600 years ago. And it's also associated with a huge meltwater pulse, glacial pulse of meltwater into the North Atlantic that is called Meltwater Pulse 1B, which I find to be a correlation. It may be more than just fortuitous. The which fact is about, that those two dates match up so perfectly.
Yeah, and that was about 400 foot sea level rise when that took place.
Well, no, not that. The 400 foot sea level rise was the totality, and it took about 5,000 years for the whole 400 feet. From its sea stand low, which was about 400 feet lower than it is right now. However, within that rising of sea, there was at least two pulses of drastically accelerated sea level rise. Short-lived, but very rapid, 10 times to 100 times more rapid than the average. If we go from full glacial maximum, glaciers are their biggest, sea level is then at its lowest. In round numbers, 400 feet lower than now, right? Okay, so in order to get sea levels up to modern, you have to melt off about 6 million cubic miles of glacial ice. Now, that glacial ice did not all melt at one time. Okay, it took 5,000 years, roughly, for that ice to melt away for the most part. But within that 5,000 years, it was not a continuum. It was not the average didn't prevail throughout that entire 5,000 years. In fact, during the Younger Dryas, it slowed down, if not even reversed a little bit. Because when the Younger Dryas cold event came on at 12,900 years ago, glaciers started to grow again. Well, you know what that means. If the glaciers start growing, what's that going to do to sea level?
Yeah.
It's going to start dropping again. So the sea level had already been rising. And in fact, the current dating of Meltwater Pulse 1A is at about 14,600. So there's about a 3,000-year span between Meltwater Pulse 1A and Meltwater Pulse 1B, 14.6 to 11.6. Right in the middle of that, between 12.8 and 12,900 years ago, is the Younger Dryas boundary. And what happened there was you had from full glacial maximum, 15 to 18,000 years ago, when the glaciers were at their most humongous extent, there was a massive pulse of meltwater at about 14,600 that seemed to kick off the melting. The next, from 14.6 until about 12.9, about 1,400 years right in there, the climate began to gradually warm. That gradual warmth can be explained pretty much by the changing geometry between the Earth and the Sun. What are the so-called Milankovitch forces? Because the Earth's tilt changes, the obliquity of the ecliptic changes, the precessional axis changes, and those three combined produces periods where it's somewhat more warmer because the Earth, say, is getting more thermal energy from the Sun. For example, if the Northern Hemisphere is tilted towards the Sun, as it does every 13,000 years, the Earth is tilting because it's going around like this. And that whole cycle takes 25,900 years, roughly. So 13,000 years ago, Polestar Vega. Now, Polestar Polaris. So you got a picture this is happening. So the Northern Hemisphere is alternating between pointing towards the Sun, pointing towards away from the Sun. Right now, the Northern Hemisphere is pointing towards the Sun, and that gives us one season. It points away from the Sun in the opposite direction 13,000 years from now. So all of that is getting to this, that there are well-established gradual mechanisms of warming. And we can see those operating at the end of the last ice age. However, at 14.6 and at 11.6, that was interrupted because sea level rapidly rose for a short period of time.
Do you have a time period there to bring context to the current climate situation? Like, is there a way to narrow it down that 50 feet in 100 years or 100 feet in 500 years? Or is there?
At rates sometimes exceeding 10 times faster than the modern rate.
Okay.
That's conservative.
Yeah, right. 10 to 100 is basically what you meant there. Yeah. Than the average. Yeah. Yeah.
Right. So we might be talking about, since the late 1800s, sea level has risen about a foot.
Right.
Right. Okay. So imagine in that same period of time that it might raise 10 to 15 feet.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the kind of rates we're looking
at. Okay. That makes sense.
Right. Because for one thing, you might have, in the case of because again, remember, that sea level raise is because of glaciers melting. So there has to be a direct connection between the rate of glacier melting and the rise of sea level. So let's get back to Atlantis.
That's a good time.
So your point, Atlantis, because sometimes I've thought Atlantis as being like this whole global civilization before the Younger Dryas.
If you take Plato at face value, that's what you have to assume. Yes. In fact, having gone through multiple times through about four or five, maybe five different translations of Plato, as well as struggling through the original Greek with a Greek lexicon next to me so I could look up the words, because I couldn't find an interlinear. I wished I could have. It would have been nice to find an interlinear version of the dialogues, you know, where you got the Greek and then you got the English. So I had to go through keywords and phrases to try to understand. Like, I didn't take the whole, every single sentence. But what I did was I went through and pulled out the key sentence where specific information is given. You know, where is Atlantis a continent or is it an island? Well, you know, a lot of the critics say, well, we know the geological evidence disproves the idea of there being any continent in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean. But, you know, when you go into the Greek, it was not continent, it was island, the word for island. So, and that's pretty important when you start talking about all the various places that Atlantis could have been. But, so, if you want to look at it this way, I you know, we're only going to be able to scratch the surface here in our conversation tonight. I mean, if you want to get more into this, we can do it again. Or, you know, I would encourage people to jump over to cosmographia.com because I think the first five episodes we did was diving deep into the Atlantis, going through Plato line by line and you know, looking at the geology and the geography and the astronomy and all of that.
Well, maybe so, what we should do is in 5 or 6 weeks, we should do a wrap-up episode.
Sure.
Because I wouldn't mind going with over, because, I mean, you're one of the people we know pretty good. We've got a pretty good relationship with you. We've hung out with you.
Yep.
We have an immense amount of respect for your vast knowledge base. And it might be fun to wrap this specific series up with, like, going over what we learned. We're going to do some Tartaria episodes.
Some Hyperborea. I want to get into that. Some DNA stuff, some giants and bloodlines. I mean, these are some of the different topics we're going to explore in this series.
So it might be fun to start it out with you and to wrap it up with you here in you know, five weeks out and see what you think about some of that stuff, depending on how far we get tonight, I suppose.
So
mid-March, yeah, okay.
So did the timing of the 9,000 years and your knowledge of the Younger Dryas lead you down towards more of a historical aspect of Atlantis instead of the other school of thought?
No. In fact, it was the other way around. I mean, I heard of Atlantis. I knew of Atlantis even as a kid. I mean, I remember in like 1959 maybe or 58 going to see this really cheesy movie on Atlantis that when I was like seven, I thought it was cheesy. That's how cheesy it was. If a seven-year-old thinks it's cheesy, you know it's cheesy. But then there was The Time Machine, which I actually came out in 1959, probably, you know, based on Jules Verne's novel, The Time Machine. Not The Time Machine, back up. Journey to the Center of the
Earth. Right.
Okay, so they go down. It was James Mason and Pat Boone, I remember. And I think I was 8 years old then, and it was pretty exciting. I was excited about that whole movie. You know, going to the Saturday picture shows back in the 1950s was a really big deal. And in that movie, they had they go to the center of the Earth and they discover that Atlantis is there. I don't know if you remember that movie. Have you ever seen it?
I think I have a long time ago. I don't remember.
Long time ago. Yeah, well, you might remember that towards the end they discovered that Atlantis is sunk and now it's in the middle of the Earth or something. So that is kind of, I think maybe, you know, right in there, one of those two movies is where I can probably first remember learning or hearing the word Atlantis, you know, as a kid, because it was, you know, pervaded the popular culture, heard about it, you know, but wasn't that interested in it because I, you know, we just figured it was a story or something. And, you know, maybe I was prejudiced because that first movie I saw was so damn cheesy. I thought, anyways, so I guess by the time I got to be an adult, you know, I'd been through the whole late 60s thing, and they were, you know, every conceivable weird and fringe idea was being imported into the discussions, right? So Atlantis was quite prominent, and, you know, there was people talking about Atlantis this and Atlantis that. And it was about that time, I think, that Well, maybe it was more like the 70s when the whole eruption of Thira was first proposed. But
and where's Thira?
That's Santorini in Greece.
In Greece?
The number three sunsets in the world.
So that can't be far from Pompeii then.
No, that's in the Greek. The Greek islands,
really.
That motherfucker's got a habit for ruining civilizations.
Yeah.
I can pull up a map here in a minute of the region. But I think what really got me first interested in it was because even as a kid, I was very interested in mythology. So mostly what was accessible to me to read as a kid was things like Greek mythology and Norse mythology, mostly. Now, in Norse mythology, there was the stories about the wars of the gods and Ragnarok and all of that, Thor and the Midgard serpent and the Fenris wolf and all of those images. And then Greek mythology, again, is full of imagery of catastrophism and so on. But then probably I must have been early 20s, so I became aware of Ignatius Donnelly. Ignatius Donnelly was a congressman from Minnesota, which was my home state. And so he wrote two books on Atlantis back in the 1880s. And he's usually the one who's blamed for the revival of sort of the modern interest in Atlantis. And I remember one of them was called Ragnarok, the Age of Fire and Gravel. And so I think I probably still have that, the original paperback version that I had gotten of that early 70s, 72, 73, 74, somewhere right in there. And it was Ragnarok, the Age of Fire and Gravel. And then the other one was Atlantis, I think the antediluvian world. I think there was two of more. The Ragnarok dealt with the catastrophe that was associated with Atlantis. And so from that respect, Ignatius Donnelly was certainly ahead of his time, because he was clearly interpreting that to transition from the glacial age to the interglacial was a catastrophic affair. And interestingly, you know what he invoked as a trigger for the catastrophic changes that occurred? What do you think?
Cometary impact?
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow. 1883.
Wow. Came out proposing that. Yeah. Yeah.
I wonder why he did that.
Well, yeah, I mean, he goes into it in his book. Oh, I mean, okay. The evidence was there even then.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah.
You know, problem is catastrophism in any shape or form pretty much got pushed onto the back burner because of the dominance of gradualism and uniformity.
Yeah.
Yeah. You can't invoke forces or processes or scales of change or rates of change that are really much different than what we're experiencing today. Because if you do, you know, you're pseudoscientific, you're trying to bring back biblical literalism, you know, if you start talking about big floods and all of that kind of stuff. But, you know, it all goes together. Yep. You know, I mean, all over the world we have ancient myths about catastrophes of usually involving, well, always involving flood or fire, and sometimes combinations of the two. So can't get away from it. So we either ignore it or we come up with some kind of convoluted explanation to explain it away, you know, that it has something to do inherent in human psychology, that people diversely spread across the globe with no contact to each other, with each other, will come up with almost exactly the same scenarios. You know, so you have the biblical account of Noah and the ark coming to rest on the mountains of Ararat, and then you come to the North American continent, and you have dozens and dozens of Native American legends about a great world-destroying flood. They talk about the great canoe, et cetera, et cetera. How does that happen? Well, usually the way around that is to say, well, obviously there were some missionaries that came in, before this, you know, this fur trader or whoever it was, or ethnographer, whoever it might have been, that was, you know, George Catlin, the Indian artist, who, you know, spent time with over 100 different Indian tribes for over a period of decades and decades, reported in his book Last Rambles, very interesting book, because what he did was he started collecting stories from the Indians. And at the conclusion of his book, he says, well, you know, for all their different customs that they have and languages and traditions, they all seem to have one thing in common. They're all descended from, you know, their ancestors who were survivors of a great world-destroying flood. Over and over and over again hearing that. Now, of course, a lot of those tribes that he was at, he was the first, you know, Caucasian, first European descended person they saw. So clearly, it's not a case of some missionary coming in there telling them the story of Noah, and then they decide that they're going to graft that into their, you know, into their whole theological tradition. So, no, they had those traditions from somewhere. And then, of course, what we now know and what I've been demonstrating over and over again, overwhelmingly in the recent episodes of Cosmographia, is that the entire North American continent was, in fact, subject to a tremendous diluvial event or series of events that were associated with the ending of the Ice Age. And this pretty much drenched the North American continent in huge amounts of water. Now, that water is going into both the Pacific Ocean and the Atlantic Ocean and the Arctic Ocean. The northern rim of the Great Ice Complex melted and created what is now the Mackenzie River Valley that carried catastrophic floods into the Arctic Ocean. You had catastrophic discharges into the North Atlantic via the Hudson River, the Connecticut River, via the St. Lawrence Seaway, through the Fox Channel. You had multiple channels by which huge amounts of meltwater were exiting into, discharging into the North Atlantic. Now, what is interesting is, if we get back to the idea that, let's go back to what Plato actually said about Atlantis. And if you take at face value, what he's saying, he's, you know, 9,000 years before Solon's journey to Egypt, where he heard from the elderly priests the story of Atlantis and the Great War, okay? So, according to the priests, and this date is given three times in the dialogues, three times, 9,000 years prior to Solon's exile in Egypt, which, again, we established the date, gives you 11,600, which correlates with the end of the Younger Dryas, which is now the date officially given for the end of the Pleistocene epoch, which lasted 2.5 million years, in the beginning of the Holocene, which is the climatic period we're in right now, which is now, we're have been in it for 11,600 years. Well, if Plato's taken at face value, what he's describing is a island civilization west of the Pillars of Heracles in the Atlantic Ocean. Now, almost all the details we get about Atlantis come from Plato. Now, we get the commentaries on Crantor by Proclus, which throws a little, has a few comments about Atlantis. Several others, very obscure, but would lead one to believe that perhaps the sailing distance was 3 to 5 days to the west. And if you sail west from the Pillars of Heracles, you run into first Madeira and then the Azores. And when sea level would have been 400 feet lower at 15,000 years ago, right, there's going to be more islands, and they're going to be much larger just because of that changing in sea level, right? Now, there's another factor that I get into it extensively in the discussions on Cosmographia, which is the isostatic adjustment to the crust itself by that redistribution of surface mass that happened because of the tremendous amount of weight removed off the continents and sent into the oceans. So, you know, you have continental drift, which is basically describing this motion of the crust. Isostasy describes this. See, we have a perfect mechanism, theoretically, for talking about how you could have not only the rise in sea level, but a major subsidence of the ocean bottom, particularly along the zones of least resistance. And if you look at the bathymetric charts of the Atlantic Ocean, yeah. What do you see? You see that hinge point, which is the Mid-Atlantic Ridge.
Wow. Do you have a map of where that is compared to the pillars of Heracles and all that? Do you have a map?
Well, I actually do, Graham. So I could, if you'd like, I could actually pull that up.
Yeah, let's look at the map. I love maps, so especially around that area, the Mediterranean, and all the history that goes back.
Oh, me too.
Darren and I were arguing over whether that flood affect how much it affected the Mediterranean.
We weren't arguing over that. We were arguing over where the coast used to be, and I said it was at the continental shelf.
In some places, yes. Typically, the continental shelf will vary from 400 foot up to 1,000 foot deep. So in some places, yeah, the continental, the water level was at the pretty much exposed most of the continental shelf. Yes, it did. Okay, let me see. All right. Oh, there we are. Okay, we'll do a share screen. Host disabled participants.
We'll fix that right away.
God, Darren. This is the way it's going to be, huh?
Did we figure out what was going on?
I think you got to make him host, and then that'll fix it.
Yeah, you got to make me host.
That's what we did last time, wasn't it? We just gave up and
under participants, probably. We gave up. We tried different things, but.
Allow to record, but that's not what we need.
Let's try that. Yeah. All right, there you go. You should have access now.
You got the keys, Randall.
The keys to the kingdom?
Keys to the kingdom. It's not much of a kingdom, but
keys to Grimerica.
That's what we got.
All right. Here we go. You like this map?
Yep.
I do. I love this map. Okay, so what we have right here is the Straits of Gibraltar, the Strait of Gibraltar, flanked by the pillars.
Okay, that's what I thought, yeah.
That's the Pillars of Heracles, which mark the gateway between the Atlantic over here to the west, the Mediterranean over here to the east. And there were actually islands in here that are now sunk.
Wow.
Yes. So anybody sailing west through here would have come to islands. Now let's go to this next. Let's see. Well, yeah. So right here, here's from Plato himself. And there was an island situated in front of the straits, which are by you, called the Pillars of Heracles. The island was larger than Libya and Asia put together and was the way to other islands. And from these, you might pass to the whole of the opposite continent.
Wow.
Which surrounds the true ocean. For this sea, which is within the Straits of Heracles, is only a harbor, having a narrow entrance. But that other is the real sea, and the surrounding land may be most truly called a boundless continent.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, right there. Let's look at this next slide here. Let me back up. Back up right here. When we look at this one, Strait of Gibraltar, Madeira is right in here. There's Madeira. And here's the Azores. So there was a collection of islands right in here.
That's a great map to show just the elevations under there, too.
Oh, yeah. Right, and I've actually got, I think I've got some better ones even on this program. So let me look what I've got here. Let's see. Here's a good one.
So Doggerland's much later.
Well, Doggerland is up by
the UK.
It's up by the UK and stuff, right?
Yeah. But take a look at this one.
Oh, yeah. So is that the Azores up in the top there that's actually poking out a little bit?
Yes, the Azores is this cluster of islands that are actually part of a whole microcontinent.
So you could picture basically all that sort of light blue being above the water.
This light where my, Kirk, can you see my cursor?
Yeah.
That's the Azores Plateau. Wow. And here's the Pillars of Heracles, and all in here are a group of sunken islands. So
they jumped from those to the middle ones, and then they're saying you can get over to the other continent from there.
Yes. There it is. I mean, right there. That's what I'm talking about. The geography checks out. Now, you know,
I mean, that could have been how they all got around before the Ice Age.
Well, you know, here's the thing. If during the Ice Age, if you were going to look for ideal real estate for the emergence of a rather advanced culture, and I'll say rather advanced because, you know, immediately you say Atlantis, people start thinking, oh, you're talking about, you know, crystal flying machines and, you know, ray guns and all of this kind of stuff, which, of course, Plato never talks about. What Plato talks about, he creates a scenario, he creates an image of an advanced maritime culture, maybe like you would picture the Minoans or the Phoenicians, but even on a grander scale. So basically what we're talking about here is a maritime culture have existed during the Ice Age? That's the question.
Right.
Is it completely out of the question that could have been a possibility? Well, if depending on how much time we have to go through some of this, if you are going to look at prime habitable real estate during the Ice Age, the Azores right here would have been a great place to live, actually. And let's see here. I might be able to actually even.
So that would, you could go sort of up and down, dotted sort of island chains there when the sea level was lower. It kind of almost looks like you've got a whole
ridge there.
Ridge you can sort of go up and down without ever having to come into contact with the mainland.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, without coming into contact with the mainland. Now, you're looking at this map. Again, over here is the Pillars of Heracles. What did Plato describe? He goes that there's a group of islands. You come to islands. Beyond those were the other islands. And here's the Azores right in here. And this is the Azores Plateau. Now, guess what? Empirical evidence suggests very strongly that the Azores Plateau recently sunk as much as a mile or two. And I can show you some of
from
that.
From what you were talking about before, about the...
From the isostatic depression?
Yes.
Wow.
Exactly. And I go into a detailed analysis of this whole question in the Cosmographia series.
So at a mile or two, you're basically talking about everything you can see there being exposed.
For the most part, like right here in this, we're looking north along the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. Here's the Azores Plateau.
Oh.
You could picture that all of the orange would have been above water.
Wow. So how deep is that now then? That's because you think it's sunk. It's like 1,000 feet, 1,500 feet in that area? Or?
Yeah, the peaks of these mountains are sticking above the waves, and that's the islands
right.
of the Azores, are the peaks of these sunken mountains.
Yeah.
And they are sunken mountains, yes. That's not some pseudoscience. That's well established by marine geology and studies. So
what about the whole ridge of the green down that whole sea there? Would that all have been exposed or?
All of this? Probably not. Probably not. This would have been like here probably was a peninsula.
Like. Yeah, right, right.
Reaching
so
out
if we're looking there. where your cursor is now, say from left to right across up. Like the actual part that would have been exposed, the orange part, what's the scale of that across there, roughly, from east to west?
Oh, 400 to 500 miles, maybe.
Oh, wow, that far, eh? Thing. Wow, so that'd be like 800 kilometers.
Yeah, maybe not that
600
much.
Kilometers, six, you, six you or 700 that, kilometers.
That Atlantis was bigger than Libya and Asia combined.
Oh, well, right, right, right.
Where I think that's a little misleading is because it's just like if you look up what is the area of Polynesia. Well, if you know, Polynesia is dozens of islands. So are you talking about just the
crow flies or,
or the whole area that's occupied by the islands?
Yeah.
And I think that's the way one should probably interpret Plato here. Because Madeira was probably part of an Atlantis kingdom.
Is there any evidence of any civilizations in the sunken area there, the Azores? Or like, what are the Azores like now? Can you go hang out there? Is it like...
Yeah, there's some islands there. You can tourist islands, yeah.
Yeah, here's the map of the islands, and you can see...
Yellow's above water?
The yellow's above water, but you can see that if you drop, like, there's 1,000 feet right there. So if you drop sea levels 1,000 feet...
I could almost
feet.
See that up there as being an old bay.
Yeah.
Where up here?
Yeah, as being the old bay where people like drop stuff off and.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, Plato says that there was ships coming day and night in and out.
Wow.
It was like the hub of a trade network.
And there's also a volcano there?
Oh, yeah, they're volcanoes, yeah. It's pretty much a volcanic complex because, see, it's right along the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. And this is one of the thinnest crustal places on the planet. And interestingly, if you look at, I kind of use oftentimes the example of Iceland, because if you were to lift the Azores Plateau above sea level, it would be about the size of Iceland. And the Mid-Atlantic Ridge, the fracture zone, runs right through Iceland, and that's why there's so many volcanoes in Iceland. And you can see the ridge actually runs through the Azores Plateau as well. So part of it is on the west and part of it is on the east, although most of the islands are on the east side of the actual ridge.
Yeah, yeah.
And there would have been a super popular, like, you can see how, like, because in my opinion, there's clear evidence for intercontinental travel back in the day.
That's what I was thinking. That's the jumping off point where they all go.
The same stuff. So it makes sense that you'd have this.
That would be the highway
civilization be in the middle, and they'd be getting the best of both worlds all the time.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we're kind of talking here as if, you know, we're accepting the fact that Atlantis was real. And in my lectures and in the presentations and stuff they do, I say, well, I'm not necessarily saying that we haven't proven that Atlantis was real. What we have done, though, is we've established a very credible basis for saying that it could have been real.
Yeah.
And until we can come up with some other documentary evidence or some kind of objective evidence that, you know, like what you were just asking, Darren, is there any evidence of, well, possibly. There's some, but, you know, the subsidence of the plateau would have undoubtedly been a catastrophic affair.
Can we take a look at some of that evidence for its subsidence?
Well, I don't see why not. Since you asked so politely,
and then also once you get that up, like how long do you think it'll take before they get real evidence of searching in the waters and the LIDAR and other means?
Does LIDAR work underwater?
I thought it did. Yeah, I thought they could map the details of the ocean floor in those shallower areas.
We should get a LIDAR for the cruise ship.
Let's just cruise around.
Then we can get a grant. Yeah, we're LIDARing. LIDAR love.
Okay, we're going to go back to 1948. This was the first
Israel
scientific excursion
thing, too.
Okay, well, that would be getting off on a tangent here.
No, let's not go.
For now.
Next season.
Next season. So this was in the National Geographic magazine, 1948. This was the first scientific expedition exploring the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. So, 1948, this was Maurice Ewing, who is considered one of the founding fathers of the modern science of oceanography. Okay, so he wrote this, quote, "We're over the ridge!" Exclamation mark. All hands were tense as the word spread through the little research vessel. Get this, the name of the research vessel, Atlantis.
Come on.
It meant we had reached our goal. A mile or so beneath our keel stretched the gloom-shrouded peaks, valleys, and ridges of the longest mountain system on Earth, the mysterious Mid-Atlantic Ridge, which we had come to explore. Though our ship was named Atlantis, we had no illusions of solving that age-old mystery. But a rather wild idea had led us to devote 4 hours to a particular rock dredging. So they're dredging, they've dropped this dredge down to the bottom, right? And on the flanks of these sunken mountains, these mountains whose peaks are the Azores Islands, they're dredging up some material, right, from a mile down. 3,000, okay. A rather wild idea had led us to devote 4 hours to a particular rock dredging. Our hypothesis was that these long level terraces, right, Now, you have to bear in mind that terraces are frequently a byproduct of an ocean level eroding a shoreline. And so, for example, you've got a shallow pitched coast. The sea level is here. If the sea level goes down, it'll cut a terrace. If the sea level comes back up, you'll now have a sunken terrace.
Yeah.
Right? Our hypothesis was that the long level terraces with sediments ranging up to 3,000 feet in depth were submerged shorelines. If so, the steep cliffs rising from them should have boulders at their bases, as do wave-cut cliffs on our shorelines today. It is, of course, extremely radical speculation to identify these level stretches more than 2 miles below the sea surface as former beaches. Such a theory would require the obvious but almost incredible conclusion that the land here has subsided 2 miles, or else the sea has risen by that amount. Much work will have to be done before this startling theory can be proved or disproved. In any case, we were encouraged to find that at the bases of the cliffs above such terraces, rocks could in fact be readily obtained.
Wow.
So in other words, exactly the evidence that they were looking for to say, well, are these submerged shorelines? There it was.
And he gave two options, but it could have been both.
Well, it was both. Yeah. Because the dominant one, I would say, was subsidence, which is isostatic. And then the rising of sea level is called eustatic, E-U-S-T-A-T-I-C. So you have isostasy and eustasy. Eustasy is the sea level rising and falling, generally because of the fluctuating glacier masses worldwide. And then isostasy is the vertical movement of the Earth's crust. So when you have
the fact that it's a giant volcano that we know erupted, like can be erupting at that time, that would also, in my head, I picture that as just helping and drive it down.
Sure, and there undoubtedly was volcanism, because you would have had extreme pressures and stresses generated along the Mid-Atlantic Ridge because of an isostatic depression, right? You could almost picture this, that as the glacier masses grow, the weight is being removed from the ocean, right? Which allows vertical movement upwards. Glacier masses shrink, dunch trillions and trillions of tons of water back into the oceans. Bottom
and
of ocean
linchpin.
So now you can almost picture there that as the glaciers wax and wane, sea level is going down and up and down and up and down in tandem. And I think that there's actually evidence that is now pretty much pointing in that direction. There's certainly evidence to show that there was massively fluctuating glacier masses, probably cyclically over the hundreds of thousands of years. Then corresponding with that, it could be that, you know, I mean, this could lead us into the idea that, hey, if we went into another ice age, Atlantis might rise again.
Mm-hmm. You just find some monolith there?
Wouldn't that be something? Yes.
I thought I heard you talking recently about how there's evidence in Hudson Bay for how far the Canadian sort of continents come up.
Yeah, I think it varies between 12 and 1,500 feet, roughly.
And that has to go somewhere, you know?
If the country of Canada
can come up 1,500 feet, that something somewhere has to go down.
Because the geoid, the planet as it's rotating, the geoid is not a perfect sphere. It's the actual shape of the planet with the equatorial bulge, the spreading at the equator, the compression at the polar axis, right? But the geoid is always trying to maintain relative stability. It's trying to stabilize its mass about its center of rotation. Well, what happens if you remove, 100 billion trillion tons of ice mass from the continent and dump it back in the ocean, or vice versa. See, what that does is it changes the geoid, and it would require, just the physics of it would require that there be changes in the Earth's rotation to accompany that, right? So not only changes in the rotation, but also compensation this way. If think of it this way, you got a beach ball, right? And if you sit, if Graham, you come and you sit on that beach ball, right? You're going to compress it this way, and the pressure will push out this way, right? Yep. So if the stresses are evenly distributed around it, you'll have a uniform radius. The axis will be uniform in any direction. You compress it this way, now you've got a shorter radius, you've got a longer radius, and a bunch of stuff in between. So in a sense, what's happening is the geoid is changing shape because of the redistribution of surface mass, right? So think about now, if you compress the beach ball, which is the huge mass of glacial ice forming, compressing the North American continent, now what you have to have is you get below the crust into the asthenosphere, you now get into this ductile plastic mass. So what does it have to do? It has to move laterally. And the pressures from beneath the Mid-Atlantic Ridge are going to be pushing it upward, right? At the same time that the weight of the ocean water is being diminished, you see? So you've got this bimodal process going on. You're removing the weight from the ocean basins, and you're creating more pressure on the bottom of the lithosphere that's going to want to push up those areas as the glacier mass grows. As the glacier mass melts, the exact opposite's going to happen. The continent's going to be rebounding. As it rebounds, you're going to have a movement of material towards that area that's rebounding, which is now going to create voids where during the ice age, you had this pressure out here. Now that pressure is being relieved, you see? So that's what we have to be able to picture. And then if you look at the Azores, they are very auspiciously placed to be highly affected by any kind of isostatic and or eustatic changes.
And now with the technology, these maps that you're using, like what was that one that you were using with the orange peaks and the different colors?
That was a digital relief map.
Yeah.
Produced probably even now back 15 years ago.
Okay, yeah.
Is there an equivalent to the Azores in the Pacific where there's that sort of Pacific hedge point, the mid-Pacific ridge?
I don't really know of anything.
Is that like Hawaii?
Well, Hawaii is along a volcanic zone, yeah. I mean, it's the whole succession of islands was produced by magmatic magma coming up through the crust.
Because you know, you think of like the Hawaiian Islands and the Easter Islands, I'm kind of picturing that as all just one big circle now that was all much...
See, I haven't done any studies in terms of isostatic adjustment in the Pacific like I have in the Atlantic. But one thing is certain, you certainly would have had the 400-foot change in sea level, which means that there are islands now that are totally submerged that could have been above the sea level, and islands that are now above sea level would have been much more extensive when you drop sea level 400 feet.
What about in the Mediterranean then? How did that rise of 400 feet affect the Mediterranean? And does that map that you looked at show anything around Santorini, or is there anything in the Mediterranean that could also be Atlantis?
Well, if again, taking Plato at face value, Atlantis had colonies, and it had outlying, trade networks, which clearly implied we're in the Mediterranean.
Right, right.
So that's how I tend to interpret it. And also, when you begin to look at mythology of the Western Hemisphere, there's plenty of stuff in there that could be consistent with a migration from the East.
Yeah.
Now, if you want to just hypothesize that there was a civilization that rose up on these islands during the Ice Age, the first sea level pulse may have begun a process of destabilization. In fact, what Plato describes is how, the Atlantean kingdom went from being this virtuous and, beneficent place to being corrupted with power and imperial ambitions. And this is what led them to try to come in and subjugate the cultures within the Mediterranean that led to the big war, right? Well, if I was going to try to imagine a scenario, I would picture that, you know, meltwater pulse 1A at 14.6 probably caused a lot of seismic and volcanic response, which would have directly affected anything that was going on the Azores. And that could have been the beginning of the decline of a culture, a civilization that had established itself there during the previous 4,000 or 5,000 years, right? Or longer.
Yeah, it could have introduced a lot of struggle too, hardship.
Yes, yes. And the motive to become imperialistic, especially if you look at what other cultures have done when faced with rapidly rising sea levels, is to build seawalls. So, you know, nothing explicitly mentioned by Plato about importing slaves for that purpose, but they were being imported for something. Mm. That was one of the things that Atlantis was doing, was capturing people and enslaving them, according to Plato, you see. So I could envision, you know, there being a necessity for some means of that. Others, you know, may have seen the handwriting on the wall as sea levels continued to rise. And then at 12,900, there was probably a rapid rise in sea level. I haven't seen the studies from the Atlantic, but there was certainly evidence that there was a gigantic influx of fresh water into the Arctic Ocean at that time, as well as probably into the North Atlantic. One of the major drainages of Glacial Lake Agassiz now seems to be falling around the Younger Dryas boundary. Then we have 11,600 year ago event, Meltwater Pulse 1B, and that could have been the coup de grace. That could have been the thing that finally caused enough of a seismic response along the Mid-Atlantic Ridge that it pretty much wiped out any culture that was living on that island group there.
Which lines up with Plato's timeline as well.
And what?
And that lines up with Plato's timeline, if that's the killing blow.
Perfectly. Lines up perfectly, yes.
And how much of that would have went into the Mediterranean? Like, was it destroyed the same level? Did the sea level come up that high there, or was that somewhat isolated?
Well, it would have been a 400-foot rise in the Mediterranean.
Same thing, eh?
It was connected with the Atlantic.
Yeah, I'd say the Mediterranean wouldn't have been affected by isostatic depression so much because
it's connected to the continent and all that. Yeah.
Yes, that's correct. And there's not the evidence. See, we could go on here.
Do you have that type of map of the Mediterranean that shows the what it was like 400 feet below? Or,
well, yes, I do.
Because is there a Suez Canal then? Like, is the Suez Canal man-made?
No, that's the
no, Darren.
No, so that was around. Does that canal still there?
The Straits of Gibraltar.
Less feet, mean? Less. Well, the Straits of Gibraltar on the east end, right? I'm thinking at the west end. The west end's the
northeast. No, other way around. You're thinking
the east end. Other way around.
Let's see what I can pull up here to.
Because the east end's the Suez Canal, right?
I think so.
About maps. Okay, let's see. I think I can come up with something here that you'll find of interest, as long as I don't take too long to find it.
Yeah, that's okay.
Let's see. Okay.
Like even the Straits of Gibraltar with 400 feet less, like it would have been way easier to cross. I mean, if, you know, the pillars of Hercules.
They must have been impressive with 400 feet less water.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I mean, connecting two continents, basically, right there, that little point.
Yeah.
Okay.
Hard to believe how close Africa and Europe is at that point.
Okay.
Was it a few miles?
I don't know how long it is. Technically, I feel like it's shorter than that, but
see, I don't know if this is or not. Let's see. Might be the one. Let's see. Yeah, I've got some great maps here that we will that I can pull up. If you give me just a second here.
Yeah, no problem.
Okay.
It says two continents are separated by 13 kilometers of ocean at the strait's narrowest point between Point Maracuay in Spain and Point Sires in Morocco. The strait's depth ranges between 300 and 900 meters, 980 and 2950 feet, 160 and 490 fathoms, which possibly interacted with the lower mean sea level of the last major glaciation 20,000 years ago, when the level of the sea is believed to have been lower by 110 to 120 meters. Ferries cross between the two continents every day in as little as 35 minutes. Part of the northern coast of the strait lies within Spain's El Estrecho National Park.
Huh. That'd be a cool spot to go check out.
Yeah. Well, this is why I'm wanting to do an Atlantis tour.
We'll need a boat.
Yep. So, is that something you can get on, Darren?
I'll start working on the boat. I've kind of been working on a boat already, so could work out.
Okay, good. Yeah. All right. I think I got the.
Quite wide then, 13 kilometers now. And I guess if there was less water, it would have been narrower back then with 400 feet less water.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It would have been definitely narrower, for sure. For sure.
Okay, if they can cross it now on a ferry in 35 minutes, I mean, you could probably
swim across
take
it.
A canoe. Yeah, maybe swim across it.
You could probably take a canoe across. I don't know about swimming across.
Okay. I think I got something here that'll be... Yeah, I think we got it. Here we go. So let me just jump, get my back here, and I.
You can almost picture if that was destroying the islands, they would have fled maybe to the Mediterranean. I mean, that's maybe the war that you're talking about. When that catastrophe happens, they're scrambling over, you know.
Well, take a look here, Graham. Okay, now this map shows very clearly the continental shelves. Look around. The UK, United Kingdom.
Here. Oh, yeah, that's right. There it is.
Now, here's the thing. During the Ice Age, these weren't even islands. This was all a unified landmass here.
Wow.
And, for example, look at the Baltic is pretty much closed off, but you can look at the Mediterranean. Now.
Oh, I see. So the darker is the deeper area there.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so when you look at the Mediterranean, there's that shelf above... Libya and Egypt, maybe, or yeah, what would that be there?
Pull in
Morocco. Morocco's on the west.
Yeah, Egypt is right here.
Yeah.
Right here. Here's the Nile coming up, and here's the Nile Delta. The Suez Canal is right here. Now, a lot of this was above ground, but not all of it. I think the depth of the shelf in here is 800 or 1,000 feet. So, what it meant was that the Mediterranean was much smaller than it is now, because again, it would have been 400 feet lower.
Mm-hmm.
Because
east of Greece and west of Turkey, there.
Yes, in this area.
Yeah,
right,
yeah, that looks like it might have been somewhat connected.
That, yes, it maybe was. I haven't really seen the absolute depths here.
Yeah, but it's a great visual.
Gives you a visual. And let's see.
And then go to the left to the Azores on this map. It shows all those islands. I mean, now you see all those islands from.
Yeah, let's pull back in there then. There's the Azores Plateau right there.
Yeah. Wow.
Right there.
And Medina.
Madeira is right here.
Yeah.
And then the Canaries are here.
Oh, yeah.
Let's see what this is. Okay, this is basically the same view, a little bit different. Let's see, we can go back here. Let's go back to North America here and take a look. So largely the coastlines of the world roughly coincided with this
with that line
drop Right. Although not always, because like I said, there was sometimes this drop off was like 1,000 feet deep. So it would have still been under 400 or 500, 600 feet of seawater.
Yeah.
But yeah, overall, the continental shelves, I mean, the continental shorelines were much further seaward during the Ice Age than they are now.
North and South America might have been connected more through the Central America.
Well, watch this now. I'm gonna toggle between this map and the next one that shows three sea level, I think 350 feet low. So it's a very conservative, but you'll still be able to get a sense of. I particularly like look up here.
Okay. Yeah.
Right up there by Alaska and.
Yeah, you got to focus on one area. Wow. Yeah, you got to focus on one area when you toggle back and forth. So do that again a couple times.
And Greenland, too.
Yeah, well, what we'll do.
Oh, even it looks like it's connected right there between South and North America down the Baja.
It's pretty darn close. Now watch. We're going to take a closer look at North America. Okay, so here's the present coastlines. Now watch this.
Jeez.
Yeah. It connects up north even. I mean.
Yeah. Mm. Look at this.
Yeah.
And then all of this area, which was not glaciated. This was a whole. You want to talk about?
Oh, that wasn't glaciated over there?
No.
Is that what they say Hyperborea is up there?
I don't know.
I'm fascinated by that too. I mean that. Yeah, so that, on looking at it from the other side, would be northeast Russia then?
Yeah, Siberia.
Siberia.
This is Beringia. Now, Beringia is a lost world.
Which seems to also have quickest temperature drop up there, too.
Yeah. And, you know, look at down here in the Caribbean. Now, let's toggle back and forth. Look at the width of the Florida Peninsula.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, that's where Bimini Road and everything is.
Yeah. Yep. Look up here. You see the islands of Nova Scotia and New Brunswick. Look at this.
Wow. Yeah, that's amazing. See, this is the map I've been looking for years, like thinking, what are the coastlines look like? What do the coastlines look like before? Yeah.
Now, here's... You know, into China area, all of this. You know, here's Vietnam, Cambodia, Thailand, Sumatra, and all of this down here that's so volcanically active. There's Australia. Okay, we're going to drop sea level 350 feet. And again, so since it's not 400 feet, this is a conservative.
Right. Right. Wow.
Jesus.
So where's Florens, like Hobbit Florensis?
Yeah, they were down in this area.
Yeah.
And they were probably living there when it was this.
Yeah. Just connected to everything. I mean, it's not hard to imagine getting around by water when it was like that. It's so hard to imagine it nowadays because, you know, the distances are so vast through the oceans. But when you really connect all these little things, there's almost a way around the whole world.
Yeah.
Without traveling too far on sea.
Yeah.
There you have it.
Let's look at Europe. You know, here's Scandinavia and United Kingdom. Here's Ireland.
Oh, yeah. I want to see this one. Up here. So Doggerland is going to be there.
Doggerland would have been this area.
And then you get those huge, giant northern plains, too.
Yeah. Now let's jump back 15,000 years.
Wow. Yeah.
That's craziness.
Yeah. It doesn't even look like the same map, does it?
No.
And that fills in the Mediterranean a bit there, too. So it also,
you can see right there.
Yeah.
You could scoot across North America, no problem.
Oops, yeah. So, yeah, and here's Iceland. And then here's this whole plateau that Iceland is on. And then, of course, if you drop sea level 400 feet, almost the whole plateau is above water.
Yeah.
So...
Huh. Well, I think we figured out where Atlantis is anyway.
Well, you guys haven't seen anything yet. I mean, how long have we been going? An hour? We got 14 more hours just to catch up what we covered on Cosmographia.
So are they making headway at the Azores then with researching the stuff? I mean, I thought Graham Hancock was saying that they were, you know, underwater there looking around, or was that you talking?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think there's anything official with any serious money behind it.
Right, right.
You know?
Like, what would you do if you had a bit of money? What would the first thing you could do to try and research this a little deeper?
Oh, a submersible.
Submersible? Just checking out the plateaus, the...
Looking
for what? Like man-made pillars and shit like that down there?
Yeah, look for anything that would suggest that it was man-made.
Yeah.
And if you remember the quote there was like, in one case, 3,000 feet of sediment. So you got a picture that in the subsidence of the island, you know, it probably happened in a series of spasms, right? Major earthquakes. And you might have had subsidence of hundreds of feet at one time, which totally could be plausible, given, you know, the nature of the crustal movement and the isostatic depression and rebound and all of that. So, you know, one of the things that is going to induce is instabilities, particularly in any mountain slopes.
They're going to be hard,
you know,
to find.
And as the water is moving up, you know, and saturating the ground, you're going to have all kinds of mass wasting events, landslides and material. So a lot of what might have been there down on the lower, near the bases of the mountains, could be buried under hundreds of feet of sediment.
Yeah.
But, you know, maybe the sediment might have preserved some stuff.
Yeah, or maybe you got to go further off the coast, or...
Why, are you going to get us some money, Graham?
One day. We'll get a boat with a submarine. We'll go check it out.
LIDAR that shit up.
So where can people go if they want to? You mentioned you did like a full deep dive on Atlantis. If our viewers want to go and decide they want to go enjoy that, where can they find that?
At cosmographia.com. Just go to randallcarlson.com. It's the web. It's the podcast that we do. We're up to about 60 episodes now. The first five, I'm pretty sure it was five, are devoted to the whole in-depth discussion of Atlantis.
Wow, that's fantastic. So is that also on video or is it mainly audio?
No, it's video as well.
Yeah. Video as well, yeah.
Yeah,
it's all going up on HowTube, which is going to roll out this coming week, I think.
Oh, awesome. Wow, nice.
Yeah, yeah, some changes are afoot.
I love it.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, I love here it. Too. I mean, it's been a great primer for Atlantis, and just
yeah, it's perfect. And we encourage everyone to head over and do the full deep dive for sure. It's a great team over there.
I like those guys a lot.
Yeah, they're fantastic. Yeah. Well, speaking of guys we like a lot, we like you a lot too, Randall, and we appreciate you taking some time out of your Saturday to do this with us.
Oh, my pleasure. Yeah. What is it? What does this mean? It's all over now?
Well, we can do another one in a few weeks if you want.
Yeah, we could. We could. Yeah, because I mean, look, we barely touched upon anything here.
Yeah.
But what we looked at was pretty cool, isn't it?
It is cool. Oh, yeah. I really like the maps where you can drop and raise and lower the sea level and stuff like that.
Yeah, isn't that great? Yeah.
That's something else.
There is some, there's amazing stuff happening. And I think, you know, as this network of us guys and people who are into this grows, and we start sharing more research and resources and stuff, I mean, I think it's going to be game changing.
I agree. It puts context as well into what's happening in our contemporary society with all the fear mongering and the climate change and all that other stuff. When you talk about stuff like this and that islands are disappearing and sea levels rising hundreds of feet, it should put some context on what's happening now, I think. I think it's important to learn that.
It is. It is. And the problem is that there's been a huge hijacking of the science. And it's emphasizing only one interpretation of the science to the neglect of other interpretations. And the narrative now is that human beings are pretty much the sole cause of climate change. And that is about as far from the truth as you could possibly get. We have tons of evidence that there are many factors. And when we talk about, when you talk about melting away 6 million cubic miles of glacial ice, now think about this, guys. Where you're at now, up there, you were under a mile of ice.
Yeah.
Where you guys are sitting right now, there was a mile of ice.
Yep, that map that I got you from you a few weeks ago shows that North American ice, and it was going all the way down into the States.
Yeah.
That ice sheet. The two ice sheets.
That ice sheet is bigger than the one that now covers the South Pole.
Yeah.
So it's not at all any kind of hyperbole or exaggeration to say that, half of North America, the only modern analog for the climate of half of North America is the South fucking Pole.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And somehow it went from a climate like the South Pole to the climate it has today within a few thousand years, and nobody can explain why. And yet, there are factions of people who say over and over again that the debate on climate change is over, the science is settled, and we should all just sit back like good little gullible citizens and just eat whatever propaganda we're spoon-fed, no matter how selective it is, no matter how cherry-picked it is.
There's also lies, and some of it's 180 degrees away from the truth. They talk about the melting in places like the Arctic and all that, I've seen people show the graphs of the ice, and it hasn't changed in 15, 20 years. And they're making it seem like things are, going the opposite.
Moving into that next season, hopefully. Yeah, we'll do a little special, deep diver. That's what we're planning on doing after this.
Yeah.
We could get into talking about a lot of things. Yeah. We could talk about sea level fluctuations. We could talk about the role of the sun. We could talk about geomagnetism. We could talk about the effects of cosmic rays. We could talk about volcanoes.
Underwater.
Appreciated roles. Yes, the list is long.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of stuff that mainstream science is deliberately, I'll say mainstream politicized science is deliberately ignoring.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Deliberately.
Well,
because it does not fit the narrative.
Well, you're going to do that on Cosmographia, so you can come here and warm up with us and get your feet wet
and
in there and practice.
I love hanging out with you guys.
Awesome.
All right,
Randall. And can't wait till May.
Absolutely.
Yeah, right.
Neither can we. We're looking forward to it. I think May will happen for sure. So
I think so, too. Yeah, we're going to have a great time.
Yeah,
absolutely. Well, this has been a great time, Randall. Thanks for helping us out with episode number one.
My pleasure and my honor, gentlemen.
Thanks, buddy.
Bye for now.
All right.
Oop, and that was our chat with the fabulous Randall Carlson. What'd you think, buddy?
Oh, yeah. Fantastic. Those are the maps I've been waiting for.
Those are?
Yep.
Absolutely.
I love it.
And do we know what one we're doing next yet? Do we know what next
week's
episode?
We don't know. It's probably going to be like either Giants and Bloodlines or Tartaria. Not sure exactly which one yet, but another one will be coming out soon.
All right, guys. Thanks for listening. See you next week.